is Frightmare Weekend. My name is Rob Galluzzo from Blumhouse.com. It's here at that website, and we make scary movies sometimes, like Sinister and Insidious and all that. But I also host the Shockwaves podcast. But the main reason that I got asked to moderate this panel, which I'm very excited about, is because Psycho is probably my favorite movie of all time. And, I'm glad you guys know that movie, and not just the show. I made a documentary about Psycho, and the only reason I made the documentary is because I wished it would continue somehow. And thankfully, A&E decided to do this great show, Bates Motel. And now the Psycho legacy lives on. So we have a lot of the cast here, and we're going to talk for the next hour about it. Let's start with, he played Chit on the show. We've got Ryan Hurst here. Probably the biggest badass in television of the last couple of years. Nestor Carbonell. The character that was saying what we were all thinking most of the time, Norman Bates' brother Dylan. And who loves Norman Bates? Freddie Highmore. Holy smokes. Alright, a few quick things. Number one, if you're in this room, spoilers. The show just ended. We're going to talk all the way to the end, so sorry. There will also be spoilers to Psycho, which is 57 years old. So sorry again about that. And first and foremost, guys, congratulations on 5 amazing years. Such a great show. Let's start from the beginning, starting with Freddie. I'm curious, now that the show has played itself out, what was the pitch when you first, like, when all of you were brought in for the show, what did they tell you the show was going to be? And did they fulfill that promise at the end of the 5 years? Now, in retrospect.
I think so. No, I hope so. It was 5 years ago. It's been quite a long time. It's hard. I think what was great is that at the end of season 3, we knew that we were going to have these last 2 years to wrap up the story, and so it feels satisfying now that we got to end it on our own terms, the way that we wanted to do, and the way that the writers, as you were saying, envisioned from the very beginning, as opposed to being part of a show that just is suddenly, you know, one season just gets the rug pulled from underneath it. But I think it was always going to be this prequel to Psycho. I mean, that's what it was pitched to me as from the very beginning. And you know, the love story in a way between Norman and his mother. And obviously there's, you know, this guy tries to get in the middle of it.
Wait, did this bleed off the screen? This little picture?
No. But I'm glad we're very excited. As Pitch, you know, finally he was able to die, and I'm very satisfied.
It should be brought up, the writer, Freddie was in the writer's room last season. And what was pitched to me was slightly different than what was shot. So somehow things changed through the course of season 5, spoiler alert. At one point I think I was supposed to kill you. And suddenly that started to change. But is anybody disappointed with that ending?
Yeah.
You told me you were going to be disappointed.
And what about you, Max? Because Dylan is a character that never existed in the Psycho mythology. And I remember when the show was announced, the complaining, it was like, Norman has a brother. Why is he listening to an iPad or whatever? You know, an iPod. Nobody cares about that shit now. But anyway. So when you get brought in and they tell you at the very beginning, you're going to be Norman's brother. And also because that character didn't exist, you think, oh shit, I don't know if I'm going to make it through the whole run. So what was Dylan described to you as?
I will tell you this. I didn't know, obviously, the outcome of the show was not described to me from the beginning. Because even though they say that they knew what would happen, it's not exactly true. They came up with some of that stuff as they went. I guess the show in general was sort of pitched to me and the type of character that I could play. And obviously, like, for me, that was, like, kind of a weird sort of position because I didn't know if everybody would react negatively to Norman having a brother because he didn't think Psycho. But I didn't really care. I was like, whatever, this is cool, mix it up. And then, to be honest, like, you know, at the end of season three, maybe sometime during season four, I don't remember, I got a call and a voicemail from one of the co-creators, and she was gushing about how great the season was and how much she loved it and stuff like that, and she sort of spilled the beans, and she left on the voicemail, she's like, you know, and to think when we first started writing the show, like, we brought in this Dylan character, and we were going to kill him in the first season. And I was like, that's funny, like, nobody mentioned that. Well, thanks. So from here on out, I always ask, how soon am I going to die? I want to know now, yes or no. Thankfully, I guess, you know, obviously they didn't, but, I don't know, man, I was just, you know, the scripts were so amazing, and just an amazing crew, cast, and, you know, I think it's kind of like all there, and so, as from an actor's standpoint, it kind of, it's like a little bit of a no-brainer.
Yeah. Can you guys hear them okay? You sure? I'm gonna have to pass this for you guys to talk, because this is the best mic, and they want to hear from you, so...
Just cast it down.
Sure. So what about you, Nestor? Because you had a little bit of history with Carlton, correct? On Lost.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I worked with Carlton on Lost, and he called me. I bumped into him at an event, and then shortly after that, he called my manager and wondered if I would come on the show as a guest star. And I said, well, sure, I'd love to work with him again. And you know, I knew it was Bates Motel, but I hadn't read anything. So he sent me the first six episodes. And I figured I'd get to him by the weekend, and I started reading it, and I was up until like 3 or 4 in the morning. I read all of them, and I couldn't wait to call him the next day, and I was like, yeah, and of course, are you kidding me? So that's the way it worked out for me. It doesn't always work out that way, but there wasn't a lot in the first season for my character in terms of development. So what he pitched to me was like, look, eventually, if there's chemistry with you and Norma, we'll pair you guys up. So. Thankfully, that worked out.
That did work out. Sort of well. Now, Ryan. So, Chick is quite a character.
Yeah. Yeah, I was actually not hired as an actor. I was hired just to clean the toilet in the production office. And then just kind of stumbled onto a set and was like, hey, give me a part.
So, like, that guy is going to write Psycho the book.
Yeah.
So what about you when they brought you onto the show? Because a lot of fans have theorized that unofficially you're sort of supposed to be Robert Block, the author of Psycho, because you're writing a book about it. And someone actually pointed this out to me today. This is how nerdy we get when it comes to these discussions, that the original Psycho ends when Norman gets arrested, and you die after Norman gets arrested, so you don't finish the book. That's where the book ends.
Very observant, yes.
Welcome.
No, I think there's, you know, just like everything in the show, I think that there's echoes that sort of call back to the show, but it's not sort of beholden to the narrative that was put down in the book or the movie. You know, when I was offered the role, originally the Chick was supposed to die. They told me from the get-go, they called me up and they said, we'd like you to play this biker who dies at the end. And I was like, you know, I'm kind of already done that. And they said, well, what if he doesn't die? And I said, I'm listening. And then And I said, you know, I just had this idea that this guy can be really ambiguous, like that you can make him that you don't know whether to laugh at him or to be terrified. And they really, we all sort of tapped into that, so.
Yeah, I feel that way right now. I don't know whether to laugh or be terrified.
I'm going to put my hand under the table. You don't know what I'm going to do.
Back to Freddie. Look, Norman Bates is one of the most famous characters in pop culture. People know who he is. You know, how much trepidation do you have about taking this role? Because it's a role of a lifetime. And at the same time, like, how do you prepare to get into the mind state of this character? Do you go back to the original movies? Did you read the book? Or did you just kind of trust what the scripts were?
I think, yeah, primarily it was sort of trusting the scripts. I think we all felt from the very beginning a sense of freedom to, perhaps because of the contemporary setting, that it didn't need to be exactly as Psycho was. And in that way, I didn't need to mimic Anthony Perkins's every move. I mean, certainly there was attempt at times, I think, as we went forward more and more to use his performance as a source of inspiration, certain things that call back and refer to the movie and are reminiscent of it. But at the same time, it was never, I never felt any real trepidation in terms of feeling that you had to live up to this other performance. I mean, you kind of just get on with your job and hope it turns out for the best.
Right.
And trust in it, yeah.
For you three guys, at what point did you realize that Bates Motel was as big as it was? And when people were coming up to you about it, were you surprised how many of them didn't know Psycho? And just a very brief story, I went to a bank, well, I think during season one or two, and I was wearing the shower scene shirt, you know? And the lovely teller was like, "What's that?" And I'm like, "It's Norman Bates from Psycho." And she's like, "Oh, like Bates Motel?" And I'm like, "Yeah." She's like, "But that's Mother." And I'm like, "No, Norman Bates kills his mother and takes her place." And she's like, "What?" And I'm like, "Oh, shit. I stole the show for you." So I'm surprised how many people, and you know, this is a good thing. I hope people will love the show and go back to the original Psycho, because it is a classic film, as is all of Alfred Hitchcock stuff. But did you guys get a sense of that you were meeting fans that had no idea that this was based on something else?
Nestor loves this one.
No, I haven't.
I'm not on Twitter. I need to get on.
You gotta go on Twitter.
No.
Yes, he does.
No, not really.
Thank you.
You got 3 followers, Rick.
There you go. I haven't quite had that experience. I mean, I know that there are people who haven't watched, you know, the film, but no, for the most part, I mean, the fans who come up to us are incredibly loyal fans, and they're so educated on the show and all the nuances, and that's the fun thing, especially about being here and meeting you guys and talking about those things that, I mean, we get into it because, you know, we love to do sort of nods to the film or just nuances in our relationship, but it's nice to see that it resonates with you guys, and when we get to talk about it, that's the fun part, you know, that, you know, you catch those little things. But in terms of, you know, I haven't quite had that experience, but I do, if you haven't watched Psycho, I recommend you watch it. We all directed this last season, so we had to watch it, we wanted to watch it to pay homage to it, and man, does that film hold up, it's phenomenal.
Yeah.
Yeah, Vince Vaughn is great. It's just great.
Let's talk briefly about the fact that you guys did get to direct this last season, which I think is, I thought all three of you did a terrific job just in terms of directing, but was that always a goal for the three of you to get an opportunity to direct something? Because I know this became a very tight-knit kind of crew, so I guess it's less intimidating to direct a show that you've been a big part of. So what was it like stepping behind the director's chair? And you know, in particular, Max, I love you guys all did little subtle nods to Psycho, but you did my favorite, which is the infamous shot of Norman kind of, when he's getting interrogated, you know, he's eating the candy corn, he doesn't understand. That great shot. Thank you.
Yeah, That show was actually kind of funny because I think in the movie he does it like in one, and we were talking to the camera guy and we're like, dude, can we make this happen in one move? Like, can you move all the way in and figure it out? And at first he's like, nah, it's really weird. I'm not like, I know it's gonna look weird, but it's gonna be awesome, you know? Convincing like some of them is kind of hard, but as far as directing the show goes, I mean, I think it was a great place for all of us to start because it was something that we were all really familiar with. As far as the look of the show, that was obviously already established. And also, I think that to some extent, it's really nice, at least I felt this on the other side as an actor, working with like these guys as a director because we're so close, and a lot of times on television, you get new directors in all the time, and you maybe don't always trust all of their decisions. So I'm not going to buy an apple. So you know, I think like when you have actors who you know so well and who you're so close with directing you, you feel this level of confidence that's higher and trust in them when you're directing. And so I think that helps a lot and sort of and transfers over, and you see that when you watch the episodes.
Yeah, there was one director who pitched that Norman had superpowers, and this is how he was going to overcome Dylan in a fight scene. I'm not sure they quite got the tone of the show. So in that way, we had an advantage. I guess I can't really say his name, but we have a good nickname for him anyway. Something along the lines of a porcupine. But no, we were really lucky to... I mean, I think Max and I were both lucky because... Sorry. because Nestor did such a brilliant job directing for season 3 and 4 that if he'd have messed up, they wouldn't really have, you know, wanted to entrust us with the opportunity to do so. And then, yeah, and the actors that you get to work with, both as actor and then as a director, you feel so lucky, like everyone... gets the scene so quickly, and you can work on the important stuff in the scene and the nuances of it, as opposed to everyone's just so professional. And I was really lucky with my episode that I got loads of snow in Vancouver, so I had the first snowy episode, and then great scenes with Max and Sheriff Green with Broke Out on the Porch. I love that one, and then of course their big kind of finale, Chicks passing, which was, it was just a joy to do it. With the little ding as his head was the typewriter. I know I'm waffling on, but it was such a pleasure to do it. And I remember the writer was on set at the time, so sort of looking over to me, and I was like this close to the monitor and breathing really heavily. And she's like, what are you doing? I'm just sort of, just so engrossed by what these two were doing. It was amazing.
Since you brought it up, I'd love to talk about Chick's untimely death. Out of curiosity, who cheered for Chick's death? Ooh. Who pooed for it? You were very well liked.
Oh. No, that was a good ending.
Just briefly, Romero's death? Good?
Thank you. Romero kill Norman? Yeah! Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so how was the guy in the hands of this guy? Because it was definitely one of the most fun bits of the final season.
It was, you know, I've said this to Nestor privately a bunch of times. While we were shooting that scene, I was having a little bit of trouble in that scene. I couldn't quite find it. There was, you know, I knew that it was going to be the end of this character. And it was my coverage. It was a shot on me. And this guy comes in. He could see that I was struggling in the scene a little bit. And totally just changed his performance. And totally amped it up and really changed the entire sort of trajectory of the scene, and it really helped me with my performance. I thought that the ending was brilliant. I loved the little ding at the end. The only thing that I ever wished that didn't make any shot was at some point there was this, I don't remember what episode it was with you and I, but I referenced you as Master Bates. Tell me this joke. It makes the cut, and it didn't make the cut.
Let's just marinate on masturbation for a second.
Yeah. Oh, did you? All right.
It's in there somewhere.
Now, for all of you guys, and I'll start with Nestor because I have a clear example. The thing that's so satisfying about the show and getting to do five seasons is that literally each and every one of you had an incredible character arc. Like, there's such a difference between season one and season five. And I'm curious, through your arc, what was the most fun aspect of your character to play? Personally, I liked husband Romero with the big black screen TV.
Well, first of all, I was so sorry to have to kill you. I read that, I go, no, come on. It was a tough scene, and you were amazing before I got here. I just didn't know my lines. That's what the scene was about. But then I remembered him, and it got better.
Yeah.
That was a tough scene to shoot, but fun. I think we're all great artists, you know, and I was lucky enough to know, or I had a sense that they were going to pair me up with Norman. That's not always the case on a show. I mean, you know, Carlton had planted that sort of that seed in me when we started it, that if we connected it. And then it was sort of told me, yeah, you guys are going to be, you know, at some point down the line. So it was nice to know that I could start sort of emotionally opposite to where I was going to end up. So a guy who was so close, he barely moved his face. You know, this is a guy who was pretty tight. Knowing full well that when I fell for her, that she would open me up. So I had that to look forward to. It only took me four seasons to get there, but finally I did. And then only to unravel completely in the fifth season and just become a madman and completely lose it. So, I mean, a role like that, and like all of our roles, it's just a genuine gift. And it's the kind of thing that you don't get to do very often on a film or a TV show, not to that extent, and to that great detail. So it was, I mean, a beautiful ride for me and I know for all these guys.
Right. And what about you, Nestor? Because you, again, you got to do so much. You get to be the loving husband and father by the end of the show, and then you're kind of in the drug trade kind of early on, give some questionable things. But again, I think the thing that people related to you is that you were kind of the audience's POV.
Yeah.
When you would comment on Norman's really weird behavior. Or like, and I've heard the term...
Everybody was thinking it, now I was just saying it, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I've heard the term turn around, that Dylan is my spirit animal. So that was the thing. What? But what was your favorite aspect to play over the course of the 5 years? Because again, you guys have to do so much.
I think, you know, I don't know, I guess like the overall arc of the character was fun to play. I mean, to be honest, like partway through, I wasn't really sure where it was going with Dylan. I was like, all right, what's gonna happen with this guy? And there were times, like honestly, where there were moments of when I was like a little disappointed because I was like, okay, I show up like this badass dude on a motorcycle smoking cigarettes, like growing weed. And by the time, like, you know, before the thing is over, I'm leaving with a baby in a minivan. You know? And I was like, huh, let's see where this goes. But obviously, like, the emotional aspects of the character and the stuff and all the layers that they put in were a lot of fun to play and kind of really sort of brought it home, so to speak, for me. So it was fun. It was a lot of fun.
And what about you, Freddie? Because you guys have used so much amazing stuff throughout the whole course of the show. I think for me personally, season four is like flawless. Your performance from the start of season four on is just like, wow. And it's a shame. He's not been on a nominated for any of this point. He's been crying. So what was your favorite aspect of playing Norman? And is he easy to let go now that the show is over?
I think all of us are finding it hard in different ways to let the show go. I mean, there's an odd sense of being used to finishing every season and going off to a separate parts of the world. But then there's always the promise of being able to return and just do another season at some point. So it'll perhaps sort of hit later on that sense of, oh, we're not going back to our house in Vancouver that's completely destroyed. It was 12 hours after we finished the exterior scene, we were back having lunch,
on stage, and then, you know, bits of the house started to come by. And I think that's the window, isn't it? And there's like the rose window. Then you'll set this image of the house just completely attacked and destroyed. They seem to have a good time tearing it down. But in terms of this season, it was great fun to explore the mother side of Norman more and more, and getting to do, and particularly with Chick, actually, towards the beginning of the season, when Norman's in the dress and the wig and kind of full-on switched into that mother persona. That was a really exciting new part to explore and kind of work in tandem with Thieriot. I guess I'd never done it before, and neither had she, this idea of creating a character that we both have been put into, and we both do takes one after the other, and kind of watch what the other person did and incorporate some of that and incorporate your own thing. So it was a real mix of two people. And then you just get adjusting to, I'm definitely told to close my legs more time, you hit the dress. It takes a while to get used to that. And the high heels, it's kind of like that. But it was great. I really like that about this year.
We'll open up to a question.
I have one funny story. The first time that I saw you dressed up as Mother, do you remember this? I walked into the makeup trailer and I was dressed as Chick. And I walk in and he's got the full get up on. And he looks over at me and he's pointing and he's laughing. He goes, "You're going to wear that."
It seemed completely normal at that stage. Normal would be. It's like, yeah, of course he's dressed. What's weird about that? Those insane things you just assume a complete normality by the end of it. Just like killing another person, why not? And that kind of feels good too. It's really cathartic, you know, getting to do those scenes in the shower and people say, "Do you take it home with you?" No, you just like get out all your murderous tendencies on set. And then you go home feeling relieved, and you have a good cry about something in real life and you kind of feel good afterwards. It's just, I'd recommend it highly. It's a good form of therapy.
But before I open it up there, the last thing I want to ask you guys about is, and you just mentioned it, the shower scene. I mean, I think this is the thing we were waiting for from the moment the show was announced. And I loved it. I thought you guys killed it. And the way that you switched it all around. How early did you know that was going to be what the shower scene was in the show version?
Well, I guess early-ish, we had an idea that, I mean, Nestor especially was, because he directed the one that preceding that, the first Brianna episode, as they became known as, the first Darren. But I think it was ultimately a really smart decision. I think everyone is at first, you know, to be honest, a little taken aback by it, because you think, oh, this is what we're actually not going to do, Psycho. People are just, there'll be riots, you know, you can't do this to Hitchcock's film. But I think ultimately it became a nice, you know, the homage was there. And you get two shower scenes, you know, for the price of one. The homage was there, but it also fitted more in line with the Bates Motel mythology that we'd created, and that it had created in its own right. And seemed like a more modern version too. It seemed that it fitted in with Rihanna's more contemporary Marion Crane and had a better message, I think, behind it.
So plus, Sam was a dick, so.
Yeah. Not as much as Romero, but yeah, they're pretty, you know. I didn't mean to say that.
I'm sure there's a lot of Bates Motel fans in the audience that would like to ask a couple of questions, so raise your hand. Sean, right here, stand up, please.
Hi. I mentioned the Nestor a little bit earlier.
Hi, David.
Yeah, anyway. I actually have read from the books of my life, and the books are conflicted about if I want to review or succeed or Bates or Norman Bates. I sort of from it, so I know it's not mental, but it's psychological. So it's very, like, conflicted. But actually, I'm not even looking for it for like 5 years now.
That's fantastic.
Because of people with disabilities, so when I was watching, I was thinking to myself, one of the few quotes I put in my book was, one of the worst weapons that you use against yourself. And, you know, I was rooting for Norman and rooting for, you know, but I, when I got to the end of the book, I didn't realize how Norman could, you know, the balance, how the balance, like, fully between his mother. So, and I want to say, like, I believe he's always going back, even though you're so deep in life. Your mind, you know, besides still dealing with myself, I mean, you can't escape. You can't feel the mind. When you feel the mind, you're not the mind. So I just wanted to mention that I empathize with Norman, regardless of the killer. I'm not a violent person. I will say, I'm a arachnophobia, and I'm not going to talk about this, I will say that the describing what I said, I could not just want to get me dead.
Thank you, Jamie. Congratulations on your book. That's awesome.
More questions?
Vera.
Terrible human being.
I mean, she's extraordinary, and I wish she were here, because I know she'd love this, and she'd love to meet you guys. She's working right now. But Vera set the tone. You know, she was the matriarch of the show in more ways than one. And she, you know, she had the show on her back the whole first three seasons. I mean, obviously, Freddie as well. But really, Vera, you know, took the bull by the horns and really helped establish the tone of the show, and as much as the actor, as the person. So here's the kind of actor who will sit on set, we all know this, rarely go back to her trailer, because she's there to work, and she's there for the crew, and she's one with the crew, and it was amazing to see that, because that set the tone for everyone. So nobody who came to set, I mean, it was rare that anyone would go back. You were all in there, sat on your chair, and waited for the lighting to be finished so we can get to it. So that, and hopefully, it spoke volumes to me, and I know it's everybody else. But yeah, she's the real deal. She's awesome.
I think that's the kind of, I mean, really, like, all of us could sit up here and talk about how amazing Vera is all day. Like, as an actress, as a person, I think that'll be one of the things that'll be really hard to move on from, I'm sure, for all of us, is not to be, like, working with her, because the past 5 years have been amazing. You honestly can't hope for somebody better to work with and spend a lot of time with, for sure.
Yeah, I think Vera is, she was wonderful. I think what she brought to the show at the very beginning, or was perhaps the first to notice and dig out, was the humor in the show. The dark humor that was always there and was present in everything that Norma did, that gave it such life, and that balanced it off against the, you know, more horror-like aspects of the show. To such an extent that, I mean, it's funny because you talk to people who are horror fans, and I've never thought that Bates Motel is a horror show at all. I mean, and I think that's testament to what Vera grounded it in emotionally from the very beginning. I mean, it's never been, you know, who's around the corner, who's the, you know, the creepy figure in the darkness, but those horror beats always felt real and grounded, as I said, offset by that humor that Vera brought. And it became so much more than just a horror show, and I think large part of that is down to her.
Any more questions? Right away.
That's what?
I don't know. That's something I'm really thinking of.
What?
Dunkle.
Some sort of euphemism.
Yeah, I think that would have majorly affected me. You know, and filming, I honestly, like, I wondered the same thing. I was sitting there kind of going, like, reading through the scripts after episode 3.
And you read the script?
Well, I read my part.
Okay.
I read my part. Let's be honest here. So I read my part and noticed that I never found out. And so for me, that was like something that I guess, I don't know, you can only fit so much stuff into the story, and obviously I guess they felt like it wasn't necessary, but I felt like it would have been interesting to show that, you know, at least in the end little sequence there or something, but I think they wanted to make that as positive as possible, so they left the sad stuff out at the end for Dylan. They thought he'd been through enough by the end of it, I think.
More questions? Way back there. You, the blonde, yes.
Okay, so my question is for Freddie. This is kind of like a throwback question. So after like season 5 ended, I went back and started rewatching the movie again, and then I went back to Missouri. And in the first 2 episodes, I just kind of realized that Norman calls Norman mom instead of mother. And I didn't know if there was like a certain thing that triggered him calling him mother, or if it was kind of a
I didn't think it wasn't a particular incident as such that sort of started the mother thing. I think that in the first few episodes there was a mixture of both mom and mother, I think, as far as I can recall. And then gradually I kind of just never said mom and just said mother, even when mom was written, and then I just kind of went with it. But it seemed to... Those little quirks, I guess, of a character can only really come in a big way, and that's not perhaps the best example because it's so, you know, prominent in Psycho anyway, but as Nestor was saying, they had 6 scripts written before we started filming, and once they start seeing people's performances and understanding what the actors are bringing to the role that's so brilliantly written on the page, then the character really does come to life, and so I think in those later episodes of the first season, for everyone who was involved, they start writing the role with you in mind, as opposed to just a role that they can't quite picture or imagine in reality yet. And that's what's been exciting about working on the TV show in general, is the opportunity for much greater collaboration in that way. You realize they're starting to write for you once they've seen the performance that you're giving. And so that's what's been exciting. Right up front here?
Norma and Alan had such an inappropriate relationship. Did the network ever want to pull back on that? And did the writers ever want to push it even further?
How inappropriate did it get?
That's your relationship. Very inappropriate.
I didn't think it was that inappropriate. No, they're very close. I mean, they've always needed...
Dangerous drugs were different all the time.
They needed each other. They, No, I don't think the network ever wanted to pull it back. I do think that it was always grounded and always suggestive as opposed to overt. I mean, probably the biggest place...
I'm going to lose Freddie's selective memory.
I just assumed that they had to reshoot because it was too much. Let's talk about that.
Hey, they didn't reshoot it. They reshot it because certain people thought it was too much. But I think the version that actually was in there was much more overt and sexual than it was originally there. It was the scene in... which episode was it? Yeah, in like episode 2 in season 4. And Norma needs to get the gun off Norma and up in the bedroom, and she kind of comes around the bed and sort of seduces him, and then you see, you know, her put her hand down, and then they added in this like close-up of her hand grabbing the gun, and you kind of like stroking the gun to like get it out of Norma's hand. I didn't think that was like any less
of a script.
That was the thing that we added in the reshoot.
It's because they didn't have the shot of the gun, so instead it was just her hand reaching down.
an enormous blissful face. But I think, you know, Norman's feelings of his mother were complicated. But I think from Norma's point of view, they were much more pure, and I think she was never into Norman in perhaps the same way Norman imagined mother at times. But Nestor really got into the, when you had to direct the
that was appropriate.
All right up here. Say that again, sorry. Did I think that Norma... I think you're right, certainly, that that there was, you know, the relationship that she had with Caleb was extremely complicated. But I truly don't think that Norma, you know, if Vera were here, I'm sure she'd have, you know, much more insight into this than any of us, but I don't think Norma ever imagined sleeping with Norma, never had a sort of desire inside her to do it. I didn't think so, maybe you do, but she got a bit mistaken along the way. And I think the tragedy of the whole thing, and it's funny sort of looking back at when I saw the last episode sort of for the last time, and you know that scene at the end that Max was so brilliant in with Norman and Dylan, and Norman says, you know, if you believe hard enough, you can make it that way. And I felt like that kind of summarized the whole show to a large extent, the idea that everyone had good intentions. Everyone was trying to do the right thing, and that they got waylaid along the way, and their own desires would get in the way. But ultimately, they were good. They were all good people. Even Norman, I think he genuinely tried to do the right thing. Romero did. Dylan did. And they all had this dream. And the sort of saddest thing is that it was almost the same dream that they all shared, and yet they still couldn't get it right. You know, Dylan saying, you know, that he wished. You know, of course he wished that Norma was still alive and that his daughter would have a grandmother and that they'd all be there as his family. And that's what Norma really wanted and Norman wanted. And they could have worked it out with Romero too. And Chick, you know, was happy to live in a house. But the sad thing is they all ended up, you know, without that very dream that they all started with.
Well, we have time for two more questions.
Gotta give it up for Emma. Really good one.
The old wifey. Olivia she's amazing. She's so talented. And, you know, when we were in the first season, she showed up, I think she was like 18. And she had like never done anything acting-wise. She came over from England. Had a really hard time breaking her accent, I think, in the first season. So much so where they wrote her a British dad. But she, like, to watch her sort of, like, blossom as an actress over 5 years was honestly, like, it was amazing. It was remarkable to watch just sort of her transformation as an actress and as a woman. It was kind of just, I don't know. It was really cool to see, and I think she's really, really sweet and kind, and we all have lots of nice things to say about her. So.
I think we have time for one more, so hand me back right there. Yep, Santa. If you could be a different character on the show?
Yeah.
Yeah, would you, if you could pick a different character to play, who would it be on the show?
Well, I think in the last scene, Nestor would have chose to have been Dylan. But that's just because of a little bit of a grudge match, but I think
so for sure.
Maybe Norman. No, I don't think I would blur it. For me, Romero was the role for sure. I couldn't ask for any more.
play Norma.
It's a wonder to be, right?
Or is there anyone else you would have played on the show if you weren't Norma?
Be Zhao?
Season 1. So do you know that Zhao is in, for those who have seen the finale, that Zhao
yes.
does make a reappearance? Zhao is the, people are right, yeah. The sex slave in season 1 who was caught up in the whole thing. I wouldn't really have wanted to play Zhao. I was more just thinking of someone at the top of my head.
And it wasn't well pulled through. But if you missed it, the sex slave from season 1 that escapes is the realtor selling the house at the end of the final episode.
Yeah.
Where we watched that. They brought her back for that. This is really cool.
That was what happened to Jal. She kind of ran off into the woods and people kept
saying, "What's happening?" All right, listen, thanks to all these guys for all their time.
Thank you.